Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jim Walters, and I chair the planning committee for the Dalton Baldwin lectureship with Rick Rice and my colleague Dave Larson. I'll say a word about Dave in just a moment. But I do want to welcome you to this, the third annual Dalton Baldwin Memorial Lectureship. Dalton, as many of you know, was a longtime professor of religion here at Loma Linda University. I think it was toward 35 years. He has served his church as a teacher, as an educator, and then here at Loma Linda, as I say, as a longtime professor. He was known for his probing of big questions of life. 2 years ago, when this lectureship began, Thomas Goyne, who is his son-in-law, referred to Dalton as educator, theologian, and provocateur. He loved to provoke big questions and at length expound on them himself. We're really happy that his wife, Barbara, can be here with us. Barbara, nice to see you again. And her daughter, Yvonne, and son-in-law, Gary, who have recently moved up to Bend, where they love the great outdoors of being right in their backyard. And we're glad that Gary, you, and Yvonne can be here today. Here's how we will proceed. We will have our lecture and then the two respondents, a brief interchange among the panelists here, and then open mics Q&A with you, the audience. Let me introduce the two panelists, and they will present in this way. Lee Greer will present first. Lee is a research biologist, but that's just how he earns his living at UCI. Of equal, if not greater, significance is his cutting-edge thinking about God, astronomy, religion, basically questions having to do with the meaning of our lives. And Lee, you'll be interested to know that Barbara remembers Dalton saying, when I told her that you would be a respondent, how much he enjoyed probing these issues with you. Erik Carter, on Tuesday, just 3 days from now, gets his PhD in practical theology from our lecturer school, the Claremont School of Theology, also Dave Larson's and my school. We have big ties with Claremont, and your predecessor in the Ingram professorship, John Cobb, started this whole thing 2 years ago, and he was Dalton Baldwin's chief professor when Dalton got his degree at Claremont. Dave will introduce our speaker. Dave is the senior religion professor at Loma Linda, in that he has been here longer than any of us, but he likes to add to that that he is not the oldest professor there, and he doesn't have Roy Branson in mind either when he says that. Dave first told me about 10 years ago, maybe it was 15 years ago, about this exciting new professor of theology who had come to Claremont, and he said, "Jim, you've got to meet him." And he was thinking of you, Philip. So Dave will do that, and we will proceed in this announced order. As soon as I pray, I invite you to bow your heads with me. God of the universe, God of our individual lives, we thank you for creating us in your image with the power to think, as we will this afternoon, and to do. Amen.
Thank you, Jim, for inviting me to introduce our speaker. Thank you for being here, Professor Clayton and Professor Carter, and to the Dalton Baldwin family for making this lectureship possible. We all remember Dalton with great joy and some weariness because he plagued us or pleased us with so many questions. And we're delighted to be here in his honor. Thanks especially to Jim for this whole series of presentations at the DiMaso Amphitheater over the school year. It's been just wonderful. Now, Jim asked me formally to introduce our speaker by referring to this, and I will do that, but he also asked me to say something less formal, so I will do that as well. If you have this piece of paper, I invite you to turn to it so that we can read the formal introduction. Philip Clayton is Ingraham Professor at the Claremont School of Theology. After holding professorships at Williams College, California State University, Sonoma, Harvard University, and Cambridge University. Having received dual PhDs from Yale University in philosophy and theology, Clayton particularly focused on the relationship between science and religion, writing such works as Explanation from Physics to Theology and Mind and Emergence, From Quantum to Consciousness, and co-editing the Oxford Handbook of Religion and Science, which I have here, and I very much recommend that everyone at Loma who can purchase this. This is a very, very helpful book. His other interests include process theology, philosophy of religion, and contemporary issues in ecology, religion, and ethics. In all, Clayton is the author or editor of over 20 books and close to 200 articles in philosophy, theology, and the religion-science debate. In recent years, Clayton has focused increasingly on the rapidly changing context for religious belief and practice in North America and around the world. He is currently working with the Convergence Network on emerging forms of Christian community and on revitalization efforts in congregations, denominations, and seminaries. All right, that was formal enough. I attempted to summarize in one sentence Philip Clayton's life and work. And here it is. Are you ready? Okay, one sentence. Philip Clayton is a theological fish, F-I-S-H, right? The word ekthus is behind there. Philip Clayton is a theological fish that swims happily in the ocean of atheism. What about that? You like that? Okay, I thought it was good. Now, this is actually quite serious because, unlike many of us, Philip Clayton did not grow up in a Christian home. His father and mother were atheists. His father was a professor of literature, and they involved themselves in many left-wing causes in North America, Northern California, I should say. And they would have been satisfied if Philip Clayton had become anything except what he became. He startled his family when somehow they discovered that he had found Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior as a teenager. Quite unexpected in this family of very, very strong atheists. So he has carried that with him all through the years. He went to Westmont College, and it was at Westmont College a philosopher challenged him with the idea that the really important things are the questions, not the answers. From there, he went to Fuller, and from Fuller, he went to Yale. Now, here's something very important. At Yale, we have two somewhat different approaches to religion. At Yale Divinity School, there is a tradition that goes all the way back to early times, which we call charismatic theology, in which people begin with particularly Christian beliefs and reason from there out to more general convictions. So that's at Yale Divinity School. And I must say, Yale Divinity School is very, insofar as we're talking about these scholars, very critical of the Enlightenment and of modernity and so forth. On the other hand, there is the Department of Religious Studies, also at Yale University, and some of those take a very different approach. Louis Dupre, for instance, who is the doctoral father of Philip Clayton, is one of those persons on the other side who builds bridges to the non-Christian world. And his assessment of the Enlightenment is nuanced and subtle. He does not just endorse the Enlightenment project, but he does review, treat it with greater respect, I think. So what we have here is Clayton on the boundary between theism and atheism in his own home, on the boundary between those two at Yale. Then he goes to Europe, and there he studies with Pannenberg, who is the one who's on the boundary between theology and science there. Clayton did not go to Europe and study with Moulton. There's a reason for that. Because Moltmann is more in the tradition of Karl Barth and in the tradition of charismatic theology instead of apologetic theology. So, Clayton spends a lot of time there, and out of this comes much of his research and much of his publications. So what we expect, now I haven't read his paper, but what we would expect is for him to build bridges between the non-Christian and the Christian world. He is not one who is going to proclaim the Christian message over some huge chasm. He is going to build a bridge between the two and invite us to find ways of cooperating, even though we may have different theological convictions. That's my hunch as to what he's going to do. Thank you for being here.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Great, I'll keep my voice out then. Can I use this just for a bit? Dave, as usual, that was brilliant. I mean, I have nothing else to say, right? You already know what's in the paper. He totally nailed it. That's actually really brilliant. My gratitude to the organizers for arranging the conference today, and to the Baldwin family for making this lectureship possible. I also want to express my thanks to the Adventist tradition, because after my conversion, the first regular Bible study I attended was the youth minister in the Adventist church in Santa Rosa, who was my first introduction to a serious study of the Bible. So this is, as Jim just figured out, my seventh trip to Loma Linda. We've now published a book together. Many of the authors are in the room, and Jim is the editor. So this is a really rich cooperative work that continues today. I hope you'll feel that way at the end of the session as well. Now, Jim Walters, it turns out, ladies and gentlemen, is prescient, because not only did he pick a topic, atheistic spirituality, which is the topic of four major books in the last year or so, which is amazing, the amount of brand new material that I had to work through to prepare this talk. But at the same time, he set the date for today's session on the very week that the Pew report was released. This compares a major study in 2007 with a study of 35,000 Americans that was completed in 2014 and just released this week. Maybe some of you, there we go. It looks like it's, yeah, we got it. Maybe some of you saw the data in newspapers, LA Times, New York Times, Washington Post, or heard it on NPR. The data, even the Pew reporters say, is staggering. The nuns, those who are non-affiliated, have risen to almost 23% of the American population. That number is 34% among younger Americans, millennials. The formal organized religion, on the other hand, has declined in virtually every sector. About 3% for Catholics and mainline Protestants, about 1% for evangelicals. That's a loss of 5 million mainline Protestants in 7 years, just under a million a year. The growth of the unaffiliated is up 6.7% in just these same 7 years, up to 22.8% of the population. That means there are approximately 56 million religiously unaffiliated Americans in the United States. This group called the nuns is now the second largest religious category in the United States. The largest is evangelical Protestant, then come the nuns, then come Roman Catholics, and then come the mainline Protestant traditions. You can actually see here some of the particular features of the net change over these 7 years. So Christian has dropped 15% over these 7 years, and the breakdown is here. Largest in Catholic, close to 11%. Second largest in the Protestant at 3.7. Evangelical gained in net numbers, but lost as a percentage, slightly as a percentage of the American population as a whole. In that time, there's been a 15% drop in Christians, those who identify as Christian. There's been a 13.6% increase in the unaffiliated. While preparing this paper, I ran across an op-ed in the Washington Post, and with that I'd like to start. The title was the provocative title, How to Take the Christ Out of Christianity. The author, Alana Macy, advocates for cultural Christianity without belief in God. And here's what she says. I remain unable to will myself into any belief in God or gods, but also unable to abandon my relationship to the Episcopalian faith into which I was born and to the ancient stories from which it came. Note the use of the word stories. Ladies and gentlemen, one thing is clear from this data. Religion is out and spirituality is in. But it appears to be a spirituality focused far more on other features than religion or God. A new kind of spirituality, which today we'll be talking about under the heading atheistic spirituality. What's really interesting is some of the main people that you would think would be defenders of religion seem to have changed sides or jumped on the bandwagon in a similar way. One of the major authors on best practices in vibrant Christian congregations is Diana Butler-Bass, whom I went to Westlawn College with, and she's just published this book, Christianity After Religion, The End of Church and the Birth of a New Spiritual Awakening. The End of Church, by this expert in church practices. And you really know something is up when one of the two most recognized heads of a religion in the world, the Dalai Lama and the Pope are the two most best known around the planet. The Dalai Lama, in the same years, publishes a book with the title Beyond Religion. Clearly, something is up. We are looking at the largest sea change in the history of American religion. It's also the most rapid change by far. Nothing comes close to it in the pace of the change that we're seeing. My interest today is to speak about this change in the way religion is perceived in our culture. Because my concern is that though the population is changing, Christians by and large don't see it. So we continue with a set of beliefs and relate to the world in the same way we have in the past, but the world has changed. You'll see me, and Dave again got that one right, you'll see me trying to see what we can learn from this new movement, and then how will I, as a Christian, respond differently in light of it. So I both want to do some listening, I'll do some criticizing, and then I'd like to offer a positive suggestion at the end. What I'd like to do is consider four of the most important books to appear in the last year or two. There they are. You can see the titles. You get some sense of the kinds of interest that these people have. In black at the bottom, I include two further texts that are extremely interesting, but I'm not able to deal with today. I presume this will all be available to people, the slides I'm giving to Jim, so maybe on the website or through the film or something. But I urge you to take some time to follow up on today's lecture by reading these. Again, asking yourself, what can I learn? Three questions. What can I learn? Where must I disagree? And how can we practice our faith, practice church, be church in the world in a different way in light of what we've now learned? Let's begin with Phil Zuckerman. He's a professor at Pitzer College in Claremont and one of the most famous secular humanists in the entire country. His book, as you see at the bottom, is called Living the Secular Life. Now, the first thing to admit is that Phil Zuckerman, whom I know as a friend, he's really involved with kids at the junior high school, actively involved in our community, warmly appreciated by the students, including students at the seminary. Phil would not like the title of this talk. So Jim, he's my authors, the one who's least satisfied with your choice, because the word spirituality is not a positive word for him. Now, he also doesn't find the word atheist a positive word. He does agree that he's an atheist and that the notion of God is no longer credible in our world. It's divisive. It sets people against each other, often in a violent way. And it's diversive because it turns our attention away from the most important issues that we face in today's world. He'd rather us be a species without, quote, any of the gods that have been created, concocted, or imagined by humans. That would qualify as an atheist sentence, wouldn't it? But he doesn't want atheism to be the focus. He much prefers the term secular humanist, because humanism connotes positive values, including caring for others and for the planet. He writes, to declare oneself a secular humanist signals an optimistic belief in the potential of humans to solve problems and to make the world a better, safer, and more just place. A secular humanist is someone who believes in reason, science, and rational inquiry, who is committed to democracy, tolerance, open debate, human rights, and so forth. He wants to switch the topic, do you understand? He wants to put our focus in a different way than the battle atheism-theism. The word spirituality is pretty negative in this book. The fun of Kindle is you can count how many times a word appears. So spirituality and its cognates appear 33 times in the text, and 32 of the references are negative. The only time it comes close to having a positive connotation is in connection with a French philosopher, André Comte-Sponville, who wrote a book called Valeur et Vérité. Here are the words that he has to say about Comte-Sponville, who muses, we live within the unfathomable. But while such a reality, he writes, that's Phil writes, can often inspire, quote, oceanic feelings of transcendence, there's nothing innately religious about this oceanic feeling. Indeed, when you feel at one with the all, you need nothing more. You see, there's just no need for the word God if you're in that space, he says. Or he continues, as the American atheist Sam Harris further expresses it, though our universe is indeed shot through with mystery, no myths need to be embraced for us to commune with the profundity of our circumstance. No personal God need be worshipped for us to live in awe at the beauty and immensity of creation. There you get a really clear statement of what motivates all the thinkers in the movement that we're talking about now. So you see this focus on the unfathomable, but the call now is toward awe. In fact, it turns out that Phil Zuckerman likes this term so much that he uses it to define his position. He calls it awe-ism. So now you have a new word to write down, awe-ism. See how your friends responded. Awe-ism includes no God and no tendency toward transcendence. Listen to his description. Thus, awe-ism, though steeped in existential wonder and soulful appreciation, is still very much grounded in this world. There's the key sentence.
You're one behind.
Oh, I'm one behind. Let's go back. Thanks. Yeah, I need somebody to be honest. Oh, one, there we go. And? That's why it's great when you have a monitor up here and you can actually see. Oh, we actually do have a monitor. Yay, now I can actually see what I'm presenting. It's akin to what philosopher Robert Solomon dubs a naturalized spirituality, a non-religious, non-theological, non-doctrinal orientation that is, quote, right here in our lives and in our world, not elsewhere. So right here, right now, focus, not transcendence. And he concludes, I live this life in the here and now, and as the days and nights pass, I occasionally experience a profound sense of transcendent, swelling awe. And I simply enjoy that feeling. My awe stops there. As Einstein wrote, we have to admire in humility the beautiful harmony of the structure of this world, as far as we can grasp it, and that is all. So the word God not only is unnecessary, but it distracts us from the here and now appreciation of our being in the world, in that magical, mystical, constructive way that we inhabit it. This is, he says, strictly naturalistic, neurological, and psychological. It's transformative without God. In fact, he says, more transformative this way. In short, for Zuckerman, nothing is lost when we abandon belief in God, and everything is gained. He says that a lack of belief in God does not render this world any less wondrous, lush, mystifying, or amazing. A free-thinking secular orientation doesn't mean that one experiences a cold, colorless existence, devoid of aesthetic inspiration, mystical wonder, unabashed appreciation, existential joy, or a deep sense of connection with others, with nature, and with the incomprehensible. He writes beautifully, doesn't he? We need more Christian authors who write this way. Quite the contrary, he says, one need not have God to feel and experience awe. One just needs life. Zuckerman doesn't like to call this spirituality, but I've placed him at the beginning of the talk because most of his friends use the word spirituality to describe exactly this kind of experience. And in our culture as a whole, especially among those who call themselves SBNR, spiritual but not religious, these kinds of sentiments are right at the center of their spiritual life. These people would say, it's incredibly important for me to be spiritual in this sense. So I would say then, in closing, about Phil Zuckerman, that he puts his finger on the shift that we're looking at today. It is not clear to me that God is quite so dispensable, so easily left out of the picture, as he says. In fact, I will argue that the idea of God can actually augment these responses rather than blocking them. With that, I'll close. Sam Harris. It was about the time of the World Trade Center that Sam Harris, a young graduate student at Berkeley, began to rise to national prominence. He published two books that became bestsellers across the United States, one called The End of Religion, and the other with a hammer sort of smashing the sacred symbols on the front, and the other one called Letter to a Christian Nation, which, if you haven't read it, basically says, stop being a Christian nation. Sam Harris became one of the leading figures in the new atheism movement, which has millions of followers across the United States and around the world. He shocked people, however, earlier in 2014, in publishing a book called Waking Up, A Guide to Spirituality Without Religion. In this book, Sam Harris claims to offer a rational approach to spirituality. Different from the new atheists who used to be his allies here, and from all religious approaches to spirituality. For him, spiritual but not religious is the right approach because it recognizes two important truths. First, our world is dangerously riven by religious doctrines that all educated people should condemn. And second, this is the new and subtle change in Sam Harris's position. There is more to understanding the human condition than science and secular culture generally admit. Spirituality should be free from religion so that we can view spiritual experiences in universal and secular terms. Interesting, that's an important sentence. Yet the anti-spiritual atheists don't have it right either. So a lot of his former allies were wrong, he now says, because spirituality remains the great whole in secularism, humanism, rationalism, and atheism. Sam Harris wants to reach out to the far left, to the most outspoken atheists in the country, and draw them back to a spirituality that is fully consistent with their atheism. It's actually a rather brilliant and important work, though I'll push back at it here in a moment. Now, religions, he says, are a net negative. They propose and condone, he says, a dogmatic mindset. They condone intolerance and in-group thinking and hatred towards others. And they give rise inevitably to fundamentalism, to fanaticism, and ultimately to terrorist violence. But spiritual practices without religion are free of all these negative consequences. So he tells us in detail about the merits of meditation, and in his chapter on spirituality at the very beginning, he calls us back to mindfulness and to the pursuit of enlightenment, which he understands in a very Buddhist sense. In fact, the book is sprinkled with sidebars that'll teach you how to take the beginning steps in meditation so that you'll be able to be yourself a meditator. Now, what's really interesting and will be a bit of a shock to Sam Harris's previous allies is that he comes out and says that transformative spiritual experiences have been a major part of his life and a major motivation for his writing the book. He says that he's had rare experiences that defend the Buddhist insight that consciousness is identical to the very reality that others mistake for God. Consciousness is this sort of transformative experience. So he wants you to come back to Buddhism as a way to investigate the mind and your experiences here in the world. Now, the book is rather strange in that whenever it talks about Eastern traditions, it's incredibly strong and positive. And whenever it talks about any of the Western Abrahamic traditions, it's universally negative. He writes, for example, that the Bible and the Quran are worse than useless. Whatever wisdom can be found in their pages is never best found there, and it's subverted time and again by ancient savagery and superstition. He says that it was as he was watching the destruction of the World Trade Center in 2001 that he realized how dangerous religion really is. We have failed, he says, to abolish the delusion and animosities of our ignorant ancestors, and he calls it religion bloody magic. By contrast, the teachings of Buddhism and Advaita in the Hindu tradition are best viewed as lab manuals and explorer's logs detailing the results of empirical research on the nature of human consciousness. In the end, then, the answer is meditation, moving beyond the illusion of a metaphysical self or a metaphysical God. and he insists nothing needs to replace religion's ludicrous and divisive doctrines, their terrifying and debasing fictions. But let's return to love, compassion, moral goodness, and self-transcendence. He has a special warning to religious people. Many of you still imagine that religion is the true repository of these virtues. To change this, we have to talk about the full range of human experience in a way that's free of dogma, as the best science already is. Two closing points then on Sam Harris. He equates God inevitably with fundamentalism, dogmatism, and intolerance. But with this rather uneven treatment of East and West, he equates meditation in the Buddhist sense with open-mindedness, scientific attitude, and progress toward these things, free of dogma and the deepest, most positive aspects of human existence. Our third example is an ex-Jesuit and Catholic theologian named Daniel McGuire, who's just written a very provocative book called Christianity Without God. This is a man who's held faculty positions at virtually every famous Catholic university in the United States, and has written works on Catholic ethics that continue to be taught around the country. In fact, he's still on the faculty of Marquette University in Wisconsin. Like the other authors, McGuire begins with his newfound atheism. He argues that God is no longer a pulsing presence. The word God is regularly reduced to a mere rhetorical flourish. In fact, he says, the word God has always been problematic. So the others say that something has shifted recently, but for McGuire, the word God was always the problem. It's a slippery mutant, he says, because the sentence, I believe in God, has no objective meaning at all. What's really surprising about this book is McGuire takes it that everything he's saying about Christianity is positive and that you all will view it as good news. So that he actually expects that you will be able to come back to Christianity now without God, without the status of Jesus as the incarnation of God, and without the belief in an afterlife. And that you'll be much happier seeing it as an epic moral narrative. It will be much more satisfying to you and a much more consistent and positive force in the world. He says that we need most urgently to respond positively and creatively to the marvel that is life. And with that motivation, we should sort of remake the Christianity that we've inherited and go back to the biblical documents with new eyes. The Bible, you see, remains a valuable moral epic. The only thing you need to do to unlock its potential is to stop reading it as prose, as claims, and now read it exclusively as poetry. Once you free the Bible from beliefs about God, incarnation, immortality, then you recognize that it's packed with power-making symbols and poetic envisionings of human potential. He says, finally, this is what he achieves. Rescued from God, his lowercase, Christianity can offer a realistic global ethic to heal a planet sinking under the effects of our ungrateful mismanagement. Now, I'm probably more critical of McGuire than any of the other three authors in today's presentation. I find it perplexing that he thinks that you could separate bone and marrow and lose nothing of Christianity when you take away that theme that has been at the center of what it's about. I find it especially perplexing that McGuire would think that millennials who've lost interest in the Christian tradition and often know little to nothing about it. I remember sitting in a church once, and a mom and a little boy walked in, and I said, Mama, who's that man hanging on a cross up there? mean, just absolutely no exposure to Christian narratives. Why would he think that this population would desire to go back to the Bible, but bereft of God or incarnation or immortality or all the metaphysical beliefs? I mean, maybe in lit departments, but why would he think that this will become a strong cultural phenomenon? So let's go back one. I think we'll just let it go there. Let me move finally to the last figure, Ronald Dworkin, Religion Without God. Dworkin was a famous legal theorist and a brilliant philosopher. He's been arguing for the objectivity of morality, of ethical judgments, without religion for many years. And he wrote this little book. He gave a series of lectures in Switzerland and then passed away before he was able to finally bring them to their form. And so somebody edited it and put the book out recently. It's a gem of a book, defending, as he says, religion without God. This one is aimed a little bit more to the philosophers of you, so you might have to stretch a little bit, but this is a fascinating and brilliant presentation. It's very different than the other three that we looked at. Here's how he defines religion at the very beginning. Think about it. Religion is a deep, distinct, and comprehensive worldview. It holds that inherent objective value permeates everything, that the universe and its creatures are awe-inspiring, remember the word, awe-ism from Zuckerman, and that human life has purpose and the universe has order. Now, all of these features, I actually agree, that is a part of what traditional religion has said, and he thinks that we need to preserve all of them, yet without the God of the Abrahamic tradition. So he wants religion, but he wants atheistic religion for our day, including these very traditional sounding features of religion, which he offers. So a religious naturalist who saves the notion of objective value, but without God. It's a brilliant presentation. I'd love to talk about what he says about Spinoza, the great Jewish philosopher, about Shelley, the romantic poet, and Einstein in particular. Einstein is sort of the bright light that guides him in this book. Here's a quote from Einstein that Dworkin finds really nails it the best. Einstein wrote, "To know that what is impenetrable to us really exists, manifesting itself as the highest wisdom, the most radiant beauty which our dull faculties can comprehend only in their most primitive forms." So this knowledge, this feeling, is at the center of true religiousness. And Einstein wrote, "In this sense and in this sense only, I belong in the ranks of devoutly religious men." Much has been made of Einstein's atheism over the years, and this is an expression of a sense of connection with the universe, of comprehending something that's really there. It's not about our feelings, it's not created by us, in a sense it's not about spirituality at all. It's about an apprehension of a dimension of reality deeper than what we see around us, but not a personal God. Dworkin comments, following Paul Tillich, this interest in the ground and abyss of being and meaning. And religion is a thing that tries to retain the presence of this depth of our existence. But all we have are symbols. No access to a personal being, but just the symbols that express our intuition of a something more. Right? Like Wordsworth says, a sense of something far more deeply interfused, whose dwelling place is in the world around us. So Dworkin offers a robust defense of religion and objective values, but without God. As he says in closing, what matters most fundamentally to the drive to live well is the conviction that there is, independently and objectively, a right way to live. But, he says, the existence or non-existence of a God doesn't figure into this instinct about value. Now, this position intrigues me immensely. it's very close to how theists think. The only thing that I think is wrong about Dworkin's book is that he says, well, from here, there's no connection to the kind of theism that many of us in the room hold. And I'd say that's false. There's the closest kind of connection between his position and theism. In fact, I'd be comfortable in describing the kind of God I believe in from this starting point, and then moving beyond it in language that Dworkin is shy about using, trying to show him that there's no reason for him to stop exactly where he stops. But instead, I'd like to close with a brief response, practicing the presence of God. You know what I'm referring to, right? You've probably heard the book by that title from Brother Lawrence, a monk who lived in the 1600s and was famous for this constant practice of the presence of God in everything that he did. He wrote, for example, at one point, "We ought not to be weary of doing little things for the love of God, who regards not the greatness of the work, but the love with which it is performed." Now, what I like about this approach, practicing the presence of God, is that it is comfortable in beginning with the ambiguity, which is our situation in our culture, in the world today. Do you get the pun? Practicing the presence of God could mean there's a God who's sort of metaphysically present in the room, like Bill there in the front row, right? And I practice being aware that God, like Bill, is sitting right there. Right? That would be the most literal understanding of practicing the presence of God. But you get the other sense that the word can have. Practicing viewing the world in such a way that it is permeated by a divine presence or spirit. Now, when I engage in that practice, I don't lead with metaphysics. I don't begin with some proof, either based on scripture or universal human reason, that there is a God with such and such properties. I convince you all by logic, and then I say, okay, go practice. Instead, I began to live in such a way that the more I live, the more I have a sense of a world permeated by a divine spirit. A world in which all of us are interconnected and interrelated. A kinship that I have with you as human beings. A kinship that I have with nature as a whole. An attempt to live with values that transcend myself, because in the end, we are not individual atoms with nothing linking us together. In the end, we are part of a single moral ethical community. As the traditional African tribes say, Ubuntu, which one translator translates, I am strong because we are strong. But practicing the presence of God is not equivalent to atheistic spirituality. I'm not just practicing the presence, I'm not just practicing a helpful myth or storytelling that motivates me in an atheistic world. I'm practicing a form of presence, a form of being in the world and being with you, a way of living and interpreting myself at every moment where the word God is indispensable. God in the sense of Dworkin, as we just looked at, a sense of something deeper than ourselves, but a sense of God which moves beyond that as well. In fact, for those of us who understand ourselves as Christian theists, aren't we actually compelled to exactly this sort of approach, much more than the apologetics and the proof texting that I was raised in as a young fundamentalist? Because what Jesus offers is, shall we call it, a Jesus-centered spirituality, a sense of being in the world in the sort of way that the Jesus portrayed in the Gospels was in the world. There were not long philosophical disputations, right? There was much more a sense of a quality of life. The woman caught in adultery and they raised their hands with stones to stone her. And he said, let him who is perfect cast the first stone, and one by one they dropped the rocks and went away. And then he says, did no one condemn you? therefore neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. And we tell story after story after story. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a mode of being in the world, a way of being with each other, which I think is ideally captured by the phrase capturing, practicing the presence of God. In closing, what I like about this approach is that it maximizes the contact that we can have with the thinkers we looked at, because in that practice, I have much to learn from Zuckerman, from Harris, from McGuire, from Dworkin, and from many of the other authors who are writing. In some ways, they may be out in front of me in practicing a mode of being where life is permeated with awe and reverence and a sense of our conviction and a sense of living in compassion with and for others. But in another way, this view expresses a deep disagreement, a disagreement that I think we'll be probing in just a moment. To believe that no event occurs in the world without God willing it to happen, so a traditional Christian belief, is not the same as believing that humans and God co-create the world that is unfolding around us today, which is my belief. Similarly, to believe that we somehow participate in the divine life, as I've just described it, is not the same as believing that there is no divine ground and creator of all things. You see, in our culture, people want to say we're all really saying exactly the same thing. And I think I need to say, no, we're not all saying exactly the same thing. But the fact that we differ doesn't mean that we need to engage in the sort of vitriol that we see in Washington, D.C., that battle to the death between opposing camps. In fact, if my understanding of my Christian theistic identity is practicing the presence of God, I can't engage in behaviors of that sort. When one begins with spiritual practices, one discovers significant common ground. There's much that we can learn from each other's practices and experiences. Awe and wonder, mindfulness and equanimity, compassion and generosity, even when we disagree about God, religion, and theology. So this calls us beyond the dogmatism, the judgmental attitudes, the vilifying of the other that has been so much a part of the Christian church's presence in our culture. It reminds me of that famous bumper sticker, my favorite. I had said, I think when Jesus said, love your enemies, he meant don't kill them. If our discussions today help us to better understand and accept those who sit on the other side of the metaphysical aisle from ourselves, our time together will have been well worth the investment of our time. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this event. Thank you, Philip. It's good to collaborate again as we have. It is off. Let me try again.
How is this? All right. How about here? Is that about good? Excellent. I am delighted to be here at my alma mater again. Although I do regret one change in the seal. It used to have a broken sword, and now it has a cross. You know, nonviolence was kind of Jesus' trademark, wasn't it?
what happened there, my alma mater. Anyway, I'm glad to be here with Philip collaborating again, and also the Dalton family. I have many more memories of spending time with Dalton, some of them right there at Glacier View during a Faith and Science conference many years ago when we were kind of alone together there in some ways. All right. Now, I agree with, I want to entitle my brief response, Atheistic Spirituality, a collaborative and corroborative response. I find very, very much to agree with Philip here. And I agree that all four of these authors are saying something similar to the same thing. And underlying, they are saying much the same thing. And we are undergoing a sea change in the American public. The general applicability of the secularization hypothesis is finally catching on in the United States, showing that we're not just an outlier to that process. And we have been delayed for other reasons. And of course, the nones, or the non-affiliated, now number over 1 billion around the world. This is not a small group. And in the United States, it's up to 56 million, according to estimates from the latest work. Now, I am going to, let's see here. Okay, so the religious landscape study, that's already been viewed, and there is a great interactive way that you can explore that state by state. But what has happened is we have seen since over the last 25 years this major, and if you will notice, those of you who are mathematically minded will notice an acceleration in the rate that is taking place in the secularization, and it is taking place across generations. By the way, it's not just the younger generations, although they are the ones changing the most, but all the way from the silent, the baby boomers, the Generation X, the older and the younger millennials, this change is taking place. And about the unaffiliated now. You have seven categories in your paper. I'm not sure that those quite fit the actual data there. Those who describe themselves as atheist or agnostic are a very small number, okay? But then when you ask many of these others in the nothing in particular group, do you believe in God? They will say no. But are you an atheist? No. Okay. Or agnostic, they'll answer the same way. So there is a lot of give and take across that. And about half of those are not interested in religion in particular as important, and others feel it is important. And that has to do with the definitions of religion, which we did not talk about. What is spirituality? It is not religion, okay? Which comes from the Latin religio, which is a belief system of rules for navigating the world, and they go back thousands of years. Spiritual comes from the Latin spiritus, a translation of the Greek pneuma, or breath. And that also is not to be confused with beliefs about supernatural beings. The spirit of anything, in our modern understanding, is the most essential principle of something. I'm using Sam Harris there. Okay, or the essence of what it is to be human or to be whatever the characteristic is that it's talking about. And spirituality in that sense is a praxis and not a belief, is a practice, a conscious way of being in the world, being in the moment, being in the present. Okay, those of you who are meditators will recognize exactly what I mean by that. And those of you who are not meditators, I invite you to join the ranks of those who meditate. Okay? Now, mystics, so it's a practice in that sense. Contemplative, mystical, a response to suffering. Mystics in all religions, and the evidence from modern neuroscience, is converging on the non-locality and illusory nature of the self or the ego. Okay? That is something that mystics, not just in the East, but in the West, have spotted. Of course, mystics in the West have had the disadvantage of often being considered heretics, okay, because they were not understood in what they were saying.
Okay. Now, why secularization? I want to spend just a moment with that. Why secularization? Well, the general answer that is usually given is the advances of science. Okay, and probably that is the major, the scientific revolution and the resulting enlightenment and the spread of technology and the arrival of mass political movements and all of that. That is probably the underlying reason. Okay, and of course, the idea was rooted in Paul Henri Thierry's Baron d'Holbach's statement in the Enlightenment, the ignorance of nature gave birth to the gods, the knowledge of nature is calculated to destroy them. Okay, but what are the immediate reasons for the rapid change now? Now, Zuckerman covers a few of those, and I'll just hit on them really quick. Backlash against the conservative Christian marriage to the Republican Party on issues like science, sexuality, reproductive freedom, the environment, and poverty. Backlash against the church for the cover-up and for the massive child rape torture scandal, as well as other scandals, hypocrisy in other words. Women in the changing workforce, revulsion against all forms of religious extremism and resulting wars since the September 11th of 2001. Increasing acceptance of gays, homosexuality, and LGBTQ rights, and articulate spokespersons for secularity, not only within the so-called New Atheists, but many other entertainers and documentarians, book writers, all of that. And then ease of access to information on the internet, which is how secularization is spreading in Saudi Arabia. 5% of Saudi Arabians consider themselves atheists or non-affiliated, okay? 5% in the most repressive society on earth. Okay, now, we have talked about God here. We haven't said what is God, so I wanted to rectify that in closing here. What is God? Which concept are you talking about when you say God? God concepts have been adopted and abandoned repeatedly as an old classic. Karen Armstrong's book showed a long time ago. You have the ubiquitous indigenous sky gods, the tribal warrior gods, which is where Yahweh was at the early stages, the axial age, which extended the borders, ethical principles, which affected many different religions at that time, the Aristotelian, the Greeks with the unmoved mover, apocalyptic, which came in from Iran, and affected Judaism, and through Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, Zoroastrianism, okay? The mystics, which are in all of these religions, and I kind of disagree with Philip's characterization of Sam Harris a little bit on a couple points. Sam Harris did not walk away from the New Atheists. He has been talking about spiritual experiences ever since. He was part of the New Atheists at all the conferences and all of that. Plus, he also critiques the East pretty strongly on metaphysical beliefs. Hence, he cites Advaita and the original earliest Buddhist teachings as being more neutral and away from the metaphysics. And of course, we know what he does with the West. Okay, the mystics, medieval scholasticism, the Renaissance and the Reformation, Enlightenment, monism, and deism, radical theology, the death of God, which is in fact started by William Blake and is making a comeback, as 2014 book just came out, the resurrecting the death of God, modern fundamentalism, and of course we have to remember that all human originated God concepts are not to be confused with what is actually real and what is out there. Okay? This quote, if there is a God, it is going to be a whole lot bigger and a whole lot more incomprehensible than anything that any theologian of any religion has ever proposed. Would you be able to say amen to that, potentially? Yeah, good. You want to know who said it? Richard Dawkins. Okay, Richard Dawkins. And Michael Dowd dedicated his book, Thank God for Evolution, to the glory of God. Not any God we may think about, speak about, believe in, or deny, but the one true God we all know and experience. Mm-hmm. because we are a part of, and this is my own quote here, the underlying causal unity of all that is, call it divine or not. And that means equal dignity for all, rejecting all divine favoritism, election, damnation, whether from Judaism, Christianity, Islam, or elsewhere. Thank you.
I'd like to thank Dr. Jim Walters for inviting me to be a part of the event this afternoon, the Dalton Baldwin Memorial Lecture, and the opportunity to respond to such an interesting paper by Dr. Clayton. So let's get into my response. Philip Clayton's taxonomy of the spirituality spectrum, where he offers considerable nuance to the theist-atheist dichotomy, is extremely helpful in getting a handle on what is happening in the world today. And you didn't really touch much on that spectrum, but so I'm working off of his manuscript here. Spirituality is on the rise while religion, especially Abrahamic religions, is being pushed to the margins of society. With the privatization of religion in the West, as well as the turn to the subjective and the failure of religion, to help nurture the deeper existential needs of people who seek meaning in their everyday lives, spirituality has gained an authority once attributed to religion. If spirituality has now become the arbiter of social identity and human interaction, then it appears as if the roles of religion and spirituality have changed places. Studies of this phenomenon abound, giving credence to a rising demographic appropriately labeled the spiritual, but not religious. But does all of this imply that spirituality can really be separated from religion? I would characterize atheistic spirituality, if defined as a form of spirituality completely cut off and independent from religion, as a rather extreme position and perhaps not even tenable. In her primer on secular spirituality, Ursula King reminds us of, quote, the mutual influence and interdependence of religious and secular forms of spirituality, which must not be overlooked, for many modern secular spiritualities are derived from either Western and Eastern ideas rooted in ancient, medieval, and early modern sources. Yet, these connections remain usually hidden and rarely publicly acknowledged, end quote. Of the atheists Clayton considers, Sam Harris is perhaps the best illustration of how this is precisely the case. I could not agree more with his evaluation of Harris's book, Waking Up, A Guide to Spirituality Without Religion, that it is a, quote, secular or post-religious interpretation of what were originally Buddhist doctrines, mindfulness, meditation, equanimity, and the like, end quote. Likewise, Daniel McGuire, a former priest and Jesuit, cannot escape the presence of religion and religious texts by advocating for the use of the Hebrew and Christian scriptures for moral guidance, devoid of dogma and God, of course. The sharp line which modern Western culture has drawn between religious affairs and secular affairs, writes longtime missionary to India, Leslie Newbegin, is itself one of the most significant peculiarities of our culture, and would be incomprehensible to the vast majority of people who've been brought into contact with this culture. After assessing the four cases for an atheistic spirituality, Clayton offers a proposal, which falls under the heading in his paper at least, Beyond Atheistic Spirituality, Practicing the Presence of God. If I understand him correctly, Clayton brings practice to the foreground as a type of mediator, which, quote, maximizes the common ground between us as children of this age without obscuring the differences that remain, end quote. For me, it is unclear whether Clayton is actually moving beyond an atheistic spirituality or splitting the difference between the theist-atheist dichotomy in the attempt to find a middle way that can allow for more latitude on matters of faith or non-faith, science, philosophy, and social justice, to just name a few. By placing practice front and center, the hope is that our actions will speak more loudly and meaningfully than our divisive words. This leads me to wonder, what does Clayton mean by practice? At one point in his paper, the manuscript that I had available to me, at one point he connects practice with what one does and how one lives, yet later he characterizes practice as a motivational force that leads to the former, how one lives. It includes acts of self-giving, care, and compassion. Perhaps practice is both. I'm also curious as to whether Clayton considers all practices of equal value. Clearly, not all practices are helpful. Some spiritual practices may even be detrimental to one's health, mental, physical, and otherwise. According to a recent book by Scott Carney, there are a swelling number of accounts that show how some forms of Tibetan Buddhist meditation, for some people, and I'm speaking primarily of Western practitioners here, can lead to mental instability and, in some cases, even suicide. It seems to me that the concept of practice is quite dynamic here. It represents a praxeological way of viewing the world and a path to knowledge construction. To quote social scientist Andreas Reckwitz, a practice is, quote, a routinized way in which bodies are moved, objects are handled, subjects are treated, things are described, and the world is understood, end quote. As such, practice is not neutral. It is theory and value laden. And if this is the case, then this causes me to question the limits of practice as somehow comprising a neutral middle ground. Put in a more colloquial way, do practices possess the goods to deliver what Clayton claims? What criteria should we use then to distinguish one practice from the other as better or worse, as true or false? Furthermore, what is the telos of practice? Where does it lead us? As for clarification on these matters, I am confident that in due time, that is in about 5 minutes, I shall receive a robust response. In conclusion, I am anxious to not be misunderstood with respect to Clayton's elevation of practice in religion and spirituality and its indistinguishable presence in both categories. I resonate very deeply with his assertion that practice should be the starting point, particularly for Christians. And I would add the primary means for mission, something that is of great import for Seventh-day Adventists. The only viable hermeneutic of the gospel today is a congregation of men and women who believe it and live by it. However, we must not eschew the necessity for words, for there is a conjoint relationship between words and deeds so that they mutually reinforce and interpret one another. On this point, I'd like to close with another reference to Newbegin, taken from his classic book, The Gospel in a Pluralist Society. Where there is a community whose members are deeply rooted in Christ as their absolute Lord and Savior, there will be a challenge by word and behavior to the ruling powers. As a result, there will be conflict and suffering for the church. Out of that conflict and suffering will arise the questioning which the world puts to the church. That is why it was not the superiority of the church's preaching which fully disarmed the Roman imperial power, but the faithfulness of its martyrs. Thank you. Okay, we'll have a little interchange among the panelists, and then we will open it up. I had wondered where we would start, but after the clear questions from Erik, I'm wondering if you would like to address the issue, Philip, of the neutrality of practice, your move toward orthopraxy as opposed to orthodoxy. Is it neutral?
Yeah, I actually don't think that question is hard, but it gives rise to two that are really hard.
And I think that that'll lead to some interesting back and forth. None of the authors, none of the four authors that I looked at, nor I, nor the material that you just finished a PhD on in spiritual practice and practical theology, is neutral. So nobody claims that just any action is fine. There are values that are promoted by every one of the authors. What's interesting about this discussion, which is very new for a Christian community, is that it involves discussions with, in this case, four people who deeply focus on a kind of kinds of practices in the world that are constructive. And I mentioned enough in the talk that I don't have to review them, but what struck me, and I'd be interested in your responses as we move to the question and answer, is aren't they, in many cases, values that you as Christians share? So one doesn't have the sense as when you encounter a particular group where you just say, whoa, you know, that set of values is so far from where I'm at, I don't know where to start. One has a sense of common ground on values and the practices they lead to. So to me, that's the easy part. The two hard questions, Erik, that your question then raises, and I send this back to both of you, is in what ways are words and beliefs constitutive of practices? So you and I stand closer in our concern about the secularization of Buddhism, and Lee is very positive about that move, or at least seems to be positive to what Sam Harris has done. So, and also with Christianity, how far can I go with a Jesus-centered spirituality without needing to give theological accounts of who the Jesus was who acted in these transformative ways in the world? So that would be the first question. And then I want to name the white elephant. There, he's standing right there. He's about 8 feet tall in the room. And the strongest way I could formulate the question, and I felt it very much in our exchange, Erik, is are there limits to the theologies that a Christian can develop? So I was once speaking in a very conservative school in Louisiana and engaging in a dialogue, and somebody said, well, there's actually, here's the sentence, do you affirm this or don't you affirm this? And if you don't affirm it, we have nothing to say to each other. So it was so clear that there was a limit of orthodoxy and that we couldn't have the conversation. And so I think the topic that's raised for us as Christians who are struggling with atheistic spirituality is, are there certain intrinsic limits, you know, lines that we cannot cross? And if that's so, we need to get those on the table and then everyone can declare where they stand. So those are two questions that I send back to you guys' instructions.
Good questions. Erik, you have just you're just finishing your degree in practical theology at Claremont, and Philip is very interested in practical theology. He once told me, how many lives have I changed through these theoretical, philosophical, theological books? I think you said half a dozen.
No, I hope not. It was more than
that. It was something like that. I remember.
So many words.
I know it. That's why you have wanted to go to where people are in their worshiping lives in congregations across the country. So you're both interested in this question. I'm wondering, where would you put the limit to the creative theologies that a Christian should abide by in dealing with these demographics that two of our speakers put on the slides?
Well, I don't know if I'm prepared to draw very distinct lines, but in more of an outline, bigger picture, from a more personal perspective, I would say that, you know, over the years, through the way that I've lived my life and the things that I've experienced, my theology has been challenged in profound ways that have caused me to question what I believe, my place in the world, where I'm going with my life. And so I don't know if I'm prepared to necessarily say there are certain lines, at least at this moment. I need to think a little bit more about that. That's a very, very good question. But I would say that I would urge Christians, especially Seventh-day Adventist Christians among us, to be open, in a sense, to the evolution of one's own theology. Because if one's theology cannot hold up under the crises of life or the burning children of Auschwitz, as one, I believe it was Greenberg, said, if your theology can't really sustain and hold oneself up during that time, obviously you have to redraw the lines in a way. So I guess that's probably all I'd say at this point.
Well, because your colleague from Claremont has thought about these questions,
yes,
which he has now raised, let's turn it back to him and say, Philip, where would you put those limits for what a creative theologian should abide by in confronting this drift away from established beliefs?
Yeah. There's a brilliant speaker named Phyllis Tickle. Some of you may know her books. Has anyone ever bumped into Phyllis Tickle before? An amazing author. She wrote a book called The Great Emergence. She said, I've been traveling around the United States meeting younger Christians in lots of places and ways, and they've taught me, and this is something I've used with the Sabbath School class when we've been here before, that the starting point for Christian life and reflection is belonging. That we belong to a redeemed community. We belong to a group that seeks to live in this Jesus-centered way. And then, out of that belonging, come certain behaviors, because we try to live consistent with that sense of belonging to this community, evolving around us. And then, we sort out our beliefs as we go. So Phyllis said, belong, behave, believe, in that order. I think there's something very profound as an understanding of what Christian theology is. I think Christians are those who respond to a life-changing individual who lived in a world in a way that constantly inspires us over the course of a lifetime, and that we seek to emulate that way of living, Jesus-centered spirituality, in community with others who seek that. We seek to live in an appropriate way, behave, and we have to sort out the beliefs as we go. So for me, if there's that genuine attempt to what Bonhoeffer called radical discipleship, the cost of discipleship, then I'm comfortable that we continue to work together on our evolving beliefs. And actually, given the last thing that Erik said, we sound pretty close on that one. Lee wants to jump in.
Yeah, since the nons are the topic,
yeah,
in part I wanted to contribute a couple of things. So Christian theologians have gone way out on some really big limbs. You know, a case in point are the Death of God theologians, who are back again, you know, in raging with their stuff. And one wonders how you would respond to that. But more important than that, though, there are a whole lot of issues in the world that Christianity is not engaging, hence the demographic results that we see today. And even this quote here by Newman, who is not here to defend themselves, in the classic book, The Gospel in a Pluralist Society, the quote that he just read is so historically false in why the Roman Empire accepted Christianity, okay, in that basically, if we're going to make claims, and Christianity and all religions make claims, they should be testable by history, by science, by other aspects, unless you're going to say this is just a faith claim. But a claim about why the Roman Empire became Christian, it wasn't because they saw faithful martyrs. It was because of the politics and the power plays that brought increasingly powerful Christian bishops into relations with the state. And if you look at Christianity today, it's constantly collaborating. It's not really challenging abuses by the state. It has done that throughout the 20th century, except for individual martyrs who are later hailed, but their organized churches were nowhere to be found when the rubber met the road. So I would suggest that a practice that goes before and above and beyond issues of orthodoxy and all of those sorts of things will engage morally with the world
and with these issues. Otherwise, you really have no reply to the atheists or to the challenge of secularists or secular humanists or other liberals.
I hear, I was taken aback, not taken aback, but I noted your enthusiasm for Ronald Dworkin's work. And for instance, that first quotation that you have, religion is a deep, distinct, comprehensive worldview. And I think we could say spirituality is that. It holds that inherent objective value permeates everything, that the universe and its creatures are awe-inspiring, that human life has purpose and the universe order. And you say, that's fine, and he's doing that without God. You want to, as I understand you, anchor that in theism. This is true because God made it true. Is that right?
I hope I can say it in a slightly more subtle way than that.
Please do, Philip.
I would say that as we begin to think in the way that Dworkin thinks or Einstein thought, and this is deep and extended conversations with Lee as well, that I think that it is a more fitting and profound understanding of that perspective to understand that ground of all things that permeates through all of what we are as not less than personal. Not personal like, who did I say it was, Tim or Bob, who was sitting in the front row?
Well, that's Bill there.
Bill, right, Bill. And that God would be sitting in a chair in the front row in a similarly concrete way. I think that notion of personal demeans God. It lowers the divine. But that the permeating spirit is not less than what we understand as personal relations and personal capacities, but infinitely more, I think is a more profound and philosophically, but also personally satisfying understanding of it. That would be my pleasure.
Thank you. Let's go to the audience. If you would come down, we have two microphones, one at each aisle. And if you would mention your name, and then if you could make a point of view or ask a question, and we will proceed. Please.
So, hi, my name is Jesse McCarthy. First, thank you all very much. It was a great presentation, particularly Dr. Clayton. I thought it was really a thoughtful kind of presentation of the New Atheists and what they're claiming. So my question is, you quoted a few people. So from Dworkin, you quoted Einstein as something, you know, talking about something like a reality deeper than us. And then you get somebody like Paul Tillich talking about symbols, kind of something that's deeper than us. And it definitely sounds like something ancient, and it sounds like Plato to me, with the forms in particular. So in talking about Plato and then going past him, you brought up the practice, you know, practice the presence of God, and you mentioned living and feeling his presence. And Plato, there was never really a defense of the forms. It was just, I kind of felt there are these forms. And it seems to me that the new atheists are doing something similar. That is, they have a feeling, just like Einstein literally says, this feeling of the deeper than us. So I'm kind of wondering if a new statement for the new atheists could be something like, the just or the righteous shall live by feeling alone. And in a sense, which I think is the dilemma that I see in both religion and the new atheists, is that ultimately it rests on faith, which ultimately is, I feel it. So in relation to my question, and in relation to an old atheist, Ayn Rand, I'd like to get your statement about that.
Thank you, Jesse. And so if you would address that, and then I'd like Lee to also address that. And Erik can if he wants. But
Jesse, it's a great question. And your question allows us to look a little bit more carefully at the four thinkers in front of us today. So it turns out they're not all appealing to feeling. And let me just briefly say how the four are different, right? Phil Zuckerman is a secular humanist who thinks that the experience of awe is very important. So his he's the typical American nun, who is probably a word feeling fits more for Phil than for the other three. Samharis means a very specific kind of feeling that arises out of a disciplined meditation in the context of Buddhist practice. And meditators would say that's not the same as just kind of exuberantly feeling high as you walk along the beach or in the forest or walk out of a great film or finish a great novel or something. Right? It is for Dan McGuire, a sense of moral power to a narrative. It's aesthetic, it's poetic, and it's ethical. So he wants an ethical Christianity without the beliefs, like that opening quote I gave from that woman, Alana. And fourthly, Dworkin is very much a philosopher like Plato, and he thinks he's a philosophical argument that without believing the following things, we can't make sense of morality as we know it. So very different. Now, in one sense, Jesse, I agree, and now I'll turn to Lee. I agree that each person is speaking of a fundamental response to the world, as is Lee, Erik, and myself as well. And that's what you called in the end of your question, faith. So there's a dimension here that depends on a response or an experience of the world that's very hard to filter into philosophical arguments and syllogisms. And there's a kind of limit of how far reason can go. But to say either it's all up to feeling, and therefore purely subjective, we can't talk about it, that doesn't seem fair. Or to say that the new atheists are reducing faith to feeling and we rise above that. That we need to be careful about that answer. Lee, where would you go?
Thank you, Jesse, for your question. What I would say is first, if one is looking at the causal connectedness of things, if one is looking at cause and effect, mathematical relations, and I have felt this feeling myself, and I know that Einstein and other people did too, that when you suddenly had a thrill when you realized a causally seamless interplay, you know, a connection that brought together a bunch of seemingly disparate facts and related them together, that's a wonderful feeling, but it's not anything to base a philosophy on. What the philosophy can and should be based on is evidence. Is evidence, and that's certainly the practice that I do when I'm doing my own mathematical analysis of DNA sequences, all of that, or when I'm using statistics, not abusing statistics, like it happens a lot in the science and faith discussions, and so forth. That is where that rests. Okay. It just so happens, though, that we can feel something else beyond. When I say feel something beyond, I do not mean it's just an intuition. Okay, you're literally recognizing that there are layers of causal connectedness that you can't begin to fathom. So there's a reality beyond there, and you're just like Newton playing on the beach, with a little stone. Or so forth, but realize that there's a great ocean of truth beyond. Okay. What we would say, those of us who are practitioners of science, lovers of science, and very often are in the nun category, okay, actually many of us are, okay, is that link there helps feed our sense of meaning as well as in our relation with others. Not in a way that you can hang any faith or of that sense, because faith itself is a very different thing. Okay, it's going in the opposite direction, I believe. But nevertheless, it enables us to grasp that we're part of something much greater, something much bigger, and make so paltry the claims of the various religions, quite frankly.
I would love to press Lee on the assertion that philosophy is based on evidence, but I won't go there at this time because we've got people at the...
Well, not quite exactly what I said, actually.
Well, I thought that was a phrase. Yes.
I was hoping to follow up with Lee along a similar thing. My name is John Testerman. Some of you know me here. Actually, you already answered or spoke to the way the question that I came up to talk about, but I want to then follow up on that. It would seem that a positive of positing this, as it were, neutral ground of values and of practice, let alone the problems of how one has a neutral ground without the visible means of support, which is where I have some disagreements with the, maybe we might disagree some over that. The advantage would be that it does build that bridge, and we saw Paul use exactly that bridge on Mars Hill when he talks about the unknown God. And he talked about that God that we can all experience, in whom we live and move and have our being, the God who is closer to us than our own breath. And that implies that there is something about this God that is experienceable. And Christ said, first you have to do my will, and then you'll start to understand. So that also points to the primacy of practice. But it seems like this experience and this practice and this community aspect of it, which gets easily culturally turned into religions, it's just how human beings are wired up to do things. So lest we get too down on religions, I mean, it is seems to be a basic human practice to culturalize things, and when you culturalize spirituality, you incarnate it into something that we call religions. And in fact, in traditional cultures around the world, we see that basically all of their wisdom tradition gets incarnated and put out into their religion in one way or another, which means that we, you know, can learn something from other people, but it's going to be tied up with their religion, kind of like it does with the Buddhism. But anyway, I did want to point out that there are Christian, going way back, Christian roots to taking precisely this kind of approach, which people such as the Stoics on Mars Hill had similar kinds of viewpoints, and he approached them in a similar way that he did.
Well, St. Paul was quoting a Stoic poet there, Eratosthenes. I believe that statement, in him we live and move and have our being, a poet who was writing about the god Zeus, by the way.
I can respond briefly.
Yes.
And that actually is a great response, Lee, to what John just said, because when you move beyond the comfortable domain of the experience and interpretation of your particular tradition, when you build a bridge and seek common ground, you begin to use language that is either borrowed from other traditions, like Paul in Acts 17:29, or experience that is shared across human beings who may not call themselves Christian or theist. And there's where the gain and the danger is. And I want to name that briefly in response to what John said. You can actually imagine three different responses. And I think that each of us faces those. Each person, let's say, who identifies himself or herself as Christian, or Jewish, or Buddhist, or whatever. The one would be to say, I won't do that. It's too dangerous. There's a school, an evangelical school by Cornelius Van Til, that says all our experience and all our labeling has to be Christian only. There's no common ground, no point of contact. The opposite side is to say, once you make contact, we're all together in a single flow of experience, and our cultural and religious differences dissolve, and we all become one without distinction. That would be a far position on the other side. And I would advocate a place where we head into that common ground, John, but we come in with the set of belief or orientation that we have, possibly changed over time, and possibly deepened in our particular location. And I think for me as a Christian thinker, that is my calling. The one I follow doesn't let me stay behind walls, carefully boarded off from the world, because he was the Son of Man who had no place to rest his head. He was in the highways and byways of his world with people with vastly different experience. I have no choice in the matter. I think Kyle and I might share that.
Epistemological humility.
In the issue that I see in what has been said here has to do somewhat with what you had said earlier, Erik, about there not being neutrality when it comes to praxis. And I'm wondering what you all would think about this generalization, and that is, we need to think in terms of a hierarchy of practices. And when you come to the more abstract level, such as love, that there is more commonality than one might think, as opposed to the way it teases itself out in the different traditions. And at that basic level, and that's where you went to love with Brother Lawrence, that's where you find the great religions, getting beyond oneself and serving others. There is great commonality, and to me that is highly significant.
Yes.
Okay, let's see. This is over here, please.
My name is Bob Hancock Jr. I want to take a shot at addressing the line Dr. Clayton, you raised the question about earlier with the elephant in the room.
Yeah.
I'm curious, as a preface, I'm very curious what that line was in the location that you referenced. You didn't tell us specifically what that line was. I don't know if there's enough anonymity in what you said today to safely disclose what that was, but I would be curious what that line was. Let's see if I can read my own writing here without my glasses. I think a line that would be drawn by most Seventh-day Adventist Christians is a belief in a self-existent, transcendent, omnipotent creator God. I've observed a tendency across conservative forms of all Abrahamic religions to unilaterally reject the idea that positive moral values can arise apart from a theistic belief. They see the title of the lecture today, Atheistic Spirituality, as inherently an oxymoron. As long as that white elephant exists, if it does, I don't see any possibility for meaningful dialogue between the emerging nun group and the Abrahamic religions. I'm curious if you would disagree or agree with that supposition, and if you agree, what possible solutions there are to creating dialogue.
Good question.
Should I start?
Yes, please.
To Erik, maybe. Erik, do you want to go first?
Go ahead.
Yeah, that gives you the chance to criticize, so you'll get the last word. Where does a Christian believer start in reflecting about, you know, what could be the nature of the ultimate? I guess I would put it a little bit differently than you just did, Bob, and I would say that for me, reflection on the ultimate, what in my tradition we call God, has to be Christomorphic. It has to take on the form, the energy of Christ. It has to reflect this core belief of our tradition that something of the ultimate was visible in the life of that particular person, Jesus. And so rather than taking a medieval scholastic word like omnipotentia, all-powerful, which had a very Aristotelian, Greek secular philosopher, emphasis, I would want it to be Christomorphic. Who was the God with whom Jesus had to deal? Whether, Bob, you and I would then converge or diverge if we spent 12 weeks at 2 hours at a time studying this, looking at all the sources that were important, including biblical sources, or whether we'd converge, I don't know. And it's that conviction, with this all closed in terms of Erik, it's that conviction that makes me think that my understanding as a theologian and Christian believer has to transcend the distinction between Christian in-group and out-group, or in this case, Christian and none. If I'm not in the highways and byways, understanding those who have spiritual experiences without using the word that's central to me, God, then I'm not following the one who's at the center of my life and practice and thought. So I find myself compelled as a Christian to challenge sharp in-group, out-group distinctions whenever they arise, in the interest of following the one who's called me into this life.
I guess what comes to my mind, Bob, is let me just build off of the question that you began with there, Philip. Where to start on reflecting on the ultimate? And let's just take Brother Lawrence, for example, or Nicholas Herman was his name. Brother Lawrence of the Resurrection was a very poor person. He grew up in abject poverty, ended up serving the 30 Years' War and was injured. And during that time, he observed a tree. And he went out into the forest and he observed a tree. And over the course of the year, he noticed that the tree lost its leaves, it seemed to die, but then in the spring, it was a type of resurrection. And it was through observing the tree that he came to, and I think an actual quote out of his book is, he came to, let's see here, it says, "The leafless tree first flashed in upon my soul the fact of God." The fact of God. Now, those are his exact words. It was the experience of observing this tree that somehow led him to God. I think that that's quite an interesting juxtaposition to Zuckerman, who says that he feels no tug towards reverence or worship of a higher power at the beauty and immensity of creation. So I guess I would just build off of that and say that experience can be one way of actually engaging and entering into dialogue with another. One might arrive at different conclusions, but there are enough shared experiences that we have where we can find those connections. This is why we all resonate so much with people's stories and with narrative. And it's a very powerful way of transmitting truth, I guess, is that we find these resonances in people's stories and people's lives. And if you take compassion, for example, this is a concept and a practice that we find in all of the major world's religions. I think that Christianity would take a different take on compassion, but there's enough common ground that we can talk about compassion as a solidarity with someone else's suffering where one feels moved to act. And that putting these two together, this is what compassion is. It's not just sort of a feeling, but it's a movement to action. I think that if all of us scroll through the Rolodex of our own experiences in our mind, I think we can all pinpoint times in our lives where we were the recipient of compassion in some way. And that right there could be a starting point. Could be a way of being able to connect and engage and enter into the dialogue and relationship.
Oh my, there's a lot more to be said. Let's recognize the two persons at the microphones, and then
I just wanted to add one thing. Yes, to that. As far as dialogue is concerned, I would invite. That dialogue needs to happen. If you're going to be serious about your gospel commission, then you owe that dialogue. And you might want to ask the question. Christians might want to ask the question, why is Jesus so much more relatable to people in the world than Christians in Christianity? You might want to ask that question and seek answers, even if they hurt, to use a politic phrase.
I might also want to just add that when we're talking about entering into dialogue, we're not just talking about words.
Correct.
Okay, we're also talking about, let's go out to San Bernardino and let's go do something together and see what happens out of that. And that's, I think, partly what I was drawing on with New Begin, really,
is that he's saying we cannot divorce the necessity of the words and the actions or the practice, but you know, the practice is what gives rise to words often. The practice is what gives rise to conversation and to dialogue and to questions. If Jesus has inaugurated a new reality according to Newbegin, then if you have a people that embody that in a community, locally, rooting oneself in a particular place over time, that something is going to happen if you are really living out the Jesus life, right?
Let's go here. Your name, please.
Mike Orlich, and thank you very much for the topic and the presentations. For Dr. Clayton, with McGuire, you pointed out how you had a few more reservations or criticisms of him in terms of maybe the authenticity or at least the likely popularity of his approach, his project. And his seems closest to the liberal Christian project to me. And the Pew statistics maybe seem to back that up, because the evangelicals are kind of hanging in there, and the nuns and the atheists and agnostics are booming. But the traditional mainline Protestant and Catholic are declining. Nevertheless, I personally feel some sympathy for McGuire's position. I haven't read him, but just in terms of not viewing religion negatively, and Western and Christian religion, not viewing it negatively, but having some intellectual difficulties with the existence of God and those kind of existential sort of things. And so I'm interested in any further comments you have about that project of working within Christianity or even within denominations when those difficulties arise. And, you know, is that a bankrupt project, or is there value to praxis and practices in those ways?
We need a whole session just to explore that one. I mean, I think from Jim's energy, it's saying be very brief. You have 40 seconds. So let me try. My problem is not with allowing people to rethink fundamental categories of that they may have inherited as Presbyterians or Methodists or Episcopalians or Adventists, and engaging with them in groups like Sabbath School here in this building, which I've often attended. My problem is with a certain gleeful dismissal of any of the question as such, as if the moment you say to a group of Christians or others, well, once we drop the God question, it'll all be easy, and everyone goes, oh, thank goodness, now it's all easy. And that's what I don't think is convincing. I've had the privilege of traveling the United States and meeting with groups of young people, mostly in their 20s, in churches and pubs and colleges and so forth. And that is the one approach that they're least interested in. They want to do what Lee and I do, which is roll up our sleeves and really talk about, is the notion of God credible? What would be and what isn't credible? Are you taking account of history and culture and relativism and all these things? And that intrigues me. Those I have more in common with Lee than with the person who says, well, the notion of God's just dumb, but pick up your Bible anyway. It won't change anything. Somebody's going to take off their coat, roll up their sleeves, and really engage with me in the struggle. What is the divine? As Lee has done, and as many other of my friends do, whether they're believers or non-believers themselves. Then I think we make progress. Thanks.
Before going to the last gentleman, let me just piggyback on this and suggest to you that Adventism has some fundamentalist sort of sounding quotes from Ellen White, but also it has some very progressive quotes from Ellen White. And given the fact that early Adventists were Arians, you're high on Jesus, they thought Jesus was just a creature like you and me, the first of all creatures, but not God. It shows to me that Adventism, by its nature, has a dynamism that often is not recognized. And it happens now that
the more conservative Adventists are in a dominant position, but there's room, it seems to me, for all, particularly given a passage like this from Christ Object Lessons. Whoever, wherever there is an impulse of love and sympathy, that is revealing the work of God's Holy Spirit. I mean, very, very broad. And with that, it seems that there is room for us, getting back to your question of what's the limit of not being obsessed with limits, but opportunities. If we are going to be a faithful community in dialogue, in coming out with parameters that serve us as a dynamic people. Please.
Hi, my name is Kevin Page, and I'd like to hear what Dr. Greer has to say about an epistemology of spirituality. My understanding is that our brains are basically recognizing data patterns that flow into us, and that's how we understand or experience the world around us. And so what would be a what would spirituality look like in terms of a data pattern? And is there a way for us to know that this is something that is not happening simply in our own brains, or are we in fact engaging something that is metaphysical or external to our own biology?
Thank you for that question. Spirituality, as I defined it earlier, as meditative practice and as connecting with with the broader universe, the broader world. One can cite actual medical studies that show the benefits of meditation in increasing empathy, improving basic health, patterns, blood pressures, so forth. But increasing empathy, what about that? Increasing empathy means being able to put yourself into someone else's shoes, to feel in part what they feel. What the sociopath actually physiologically can't do is feel what your pain, or put themselves in your place or in my place. And so literally the parts of their brain which are involved with that are damaged. Okay. However, it is not just mysticism or nice happy talk to say that we are connected with every living thing and with all parts of the creation and the universe. We are in fact directly biologically related for one, and we share the same biosphere. And we have a relation with the future in the children and in those who are coming. We owe them a moral debt. Traditional religions don't talk too often about that moral debt to the future. And we also have a debt to memory and to be truthful about the past and all of that. So a meditative practice, a spiritual practice, what it looks like is literally to become fully human, to be human in all of the best characteristics of being human. I like Jesus on that realm. I don't think that he was alone. I think there were others that were quite similar like that. Probably the Buddha might be one, and there are people in our day that have similar spiritual practices. As far as what it actually looks like, yeah, brains of meditating nuns and Tibetan monks have been studied under functional MRI, and we actually we're starting little bits of understanding about how that works, what parts of the brain are exercised in that way of being, and also in compassion and all of that. And there's a big overlap in those areas.
Oh, we have only paid Philip Clayton to be here until 5:00. No, just kidding.
It's over time. But it is Sabbath, though, Jim. Right.
That's
right.
He will have a concluding thought, and then we're going to go home. So Philip, again, thank you for coming here and being the lecturer, the third Dalton Baldwin Memorial Lecturer. And if you would have a concluding word, if you care to, and then we will let you go.
So, ladies and gentlemen, today we engage some of the most provocative thinkers of very recent history. We engage thinkers who advanced positions that many would call a contradiction in terms, as one of this early question askers did. And we listened to their particular terms. We struggled. I think three good things happened today. The first good thing is you are here. And then here at Loma Linda, in an audience mostly, I think, of Adventists, we looked at these views and listened carefully to them. If I read your body language, you were engaged, a lot of you were leaning forward, you're learning, you're listening, and trying to comprehend. And for that, I praise you. I think that's a positive thing. Second, no one said in the discussion, like my interlocutor in Louisiana, it's all black and white. It's really simple, Dr. Clayton. It's just this. And told us all that it was an easy answer. And that means that you and were willing to be with us in the complexity of the issues, in the struggle that they represent, and in the growth that comes from struggle. And the third and last thing that I think is good today is that there's space within the Adventist tradition to have this discussion. For a tradition and its followers to look again to the scriptures and tradition, to reason and to experience, to struggle with the question, what does it mean to be Christian today? What does it mean to be Jesus followers today? Not by drawing sharp lines, but by engaging with provocative thinkers with whom I expected 90% of you disagreed, listening and learning, and being able to say in a more nuanced way, what does it mean to be Christian in 2015? And saying that, then, as the gospel says, to go thou and do likewise, to be ready to walk out of an auditorium and into Starbucks or a school or a workplace or wherever you live, to begin to live out that complexity of life, Christian life in today's world. And I think as we thought to be a team who worked together to understand, I sensed you as a team that was with us trying to understand. And for that, I praise you.
Let's thank good rest of the Sabbath.